Hi, welcome to the conversation about stigmas, questions, and pros of counseling and mental health. My name is Dr. Ryan Burkhart. I am the program director of the Master of Arts in Clinical Mental Health Counseling at Colorado Christian University. I'm also a licensed professional counselor in Colorado.
I'm Dr. Trent Langhofer, so thankful to be here today. I'm the clinic director for the Community Mental Health Counseling Center at Colorado Christian University. I'm an adjunct professor at CCU. I'm also a licensed professional counselor here in the state of Colorado. Really excited to get to share some thoughts with you today.
So Trent, today we're circling up and talking about some of the stigmas or questions that people may have as they are either attempting or getting ready to engage counseling or mental health services. I know you and I have talked about some of the most common fears that we see in people who are considering engaging a professional mental health counselor. And I'm wondering if we can just kind of open up, what's some of the fears that you see that often kind of prevent people from making that phone call to a counselor?
Yeah, Ryan, I've been doing clinical mental health counseling for the better part of a decade, and I think there are a handful that are pretty common, you know, so I'm going to list a few briefly, and then we can maybe talk some more about these, but for me, one really common fear that seems to make counseling difficult to consider for some people is the fear of being labeled. I think people have the underlying belief that, man, counseling is for crazy people. The truth is, everybody got a little bit of crazy. You know, but the fear of being labeled really is one of the things that I think can be a barrier to getting mental health counseling care. A second, Ryan, is the fear of being helpless. You know, people maybe come to counseling with this thought that, man, if I need counseling, then I'm weak. And that's just not true, you know. And we can talk about that. Another one is that I don't need counseling. I just need to work harder. And we live in a culture that really values hard work and self-starters and that kind of thing. And I think underlying that is the fear of what acceptance really means for me. If I accept my flaws, then I have to take responsibility for them. And then I got to do the hard work of changing them.
Yeah, and that's just about, when you think about those three things, right? This idea of being labeled, of being given a label or a name around something that ultimately may mean something about you. And then this idea of, at times, I've heard people talk about, if I get this diagnosis or if I get this label, I'll be helpless to even change it. So even that helplessness in terms of being afraid to even address this new thing that you now have, which that really isn't the intention of counseling, is to give people labels. And then this idea of just of not being accepted. I mean, all of this actually kind of all goes together in really kind of our core issues.
There's no question. And we live in what some have called, I've called our culture, this a highlight reel society. Man, where we just broadcast our Hall of Fame moments, our highlight reel moments. And when we have such overexposure to everybody else's highlight reel kind of moments, and we know our own faults and failures and shortcomings better than anybody else, and we compare the two, our faults and failures to everybody else's highlight reel moments, it's like, man, I'm worried I'm going to be labeled as crazy or that going to counseling makes me helpless, or that I can't be accepted in a society that's kind of highlight reel oriented.
There's even research coming out talking about how social media and how in which the way in which our culture engages social media is actually contributing to some of that. So for example, I mean, most people, whenever they engage social media, the things they put on social media often contribute to the perception they want others to have about themselves. So
Right. You
really don't put things typically on social media that we think others, you know, may think badly of us, right? So when we're, you know, out with friends, we'll post a picture or we'll do a quick video when we're at a Rockies game or something. And what some of the research is showing is that when you're just scrolling through your phone and you're seeing, you know, a 10-second video or a picture for 10 seconds, and it's like, man, that person's life looks great. That person's life looks great. Look at what they're doing. What the research is showing is it's actually creating this sense of despair and hopelessness in a lot of people, because we have a tendency at a subconscious level to actually compare ourselves to others as we attempt to understand how we're doing. So this idea of, I may need counseling, I may need someone to talk to kind of help me get through this, we have this natural tendency to say, I need counseling, but they don't. And it just brings all this stuff up.
Yeah, and I'm definitely not posting on my social media the time I got in a big fight with my wife or yelled at the kids, right? We got a flat tire and we're late to a meeting. And everybody experiences that. And I think too, Ryan, that we our faults and failures, they hurt. And I think there's another underlying fear that if I go to counseling, I'm just going to get advice and they're just going to tell me what I need to do different or better. And that's also not what counseling is about. You know, it's not an advice giving arrangement. Certainly that can be a component of counseling, but what I also think happens is that people get so overwhelmed by their hurt that could be the result of their own faults and failures or other people's faults and failures and the way those other people's faults and failures have hurt them. It's like, man, the last place I want to go is some place where somebody's just going to tell me what I've done wrong and how I need to do things differently.
Yeah.
And often counseling is just the opposite. Counseling can very much be strengths-based, right? And help people get in touch with what their strengths are and facilitate a person's capacity to live in their strengths.
Yeah. And we know how do we train counselors, right? We train counselors we tell them the best thing you can do for someone who sits across from you in a session is just be present with them and just to listen. And I think that is something that's pretty rare anymore in our culture to have a type of relationship. And in counseling, we would call it the therapeutic relationship, but to have a relationship where the whole purpose of that relationship is just to hear me out, to be focused on me, this idea of unconditionally positively regarding the person across from you. And I think that's the piece that sometimes people forget with counseling is, you know, we typically, counselors have had to work through their own stuff. Like we typically can't sit in a session with someone until we become aware of our own messed upness and worked through it ourselves. And it's only when we're able to do that, that we're able to sit across from somebody. So this idea that it is just about advice giving, it really isn't. It's about hearing who you are, understanding your story, and accepting you where you're at. That's the heart of counseling.
And I read a study just this week where some researchers were trying to gauge the value of validating and listening to people. And so they asked some students to come to a lab and to do this task that was like a crossword puzzle. And so at the end of the crossword puzzle, the students could turn it in for a cash reward, right? So one group, when they turned in their crossword puzzle, the researchers thanked them for it, asked them if they had trouble or questions for it, and then asked them if they wanted to repeat the task. The second group, the researchers just got the paper with them and paid them. And the third group, the researchers got the paper and shredded it. So the catch is, each time the paper was turned in, there was a decrease in the amount of reimbursement. Mm-hmm. And the people who were validated and listened to, whose concerns were accommodated, those people, by a significant percentage, continued the task to the point they weren't even paid to do it. Right. So just to be validated and heard and listened to is so motivating. Yeah. It helps you stick through the tough stuff. It helps you keep going. It helps you find the courage to face fears. And so this the study after study, this was just a fun one. You could get people to do crossword puzzles for small dollar amounts. If you just tell them that they're great, ask them if they need any help or have any questions they want to be answered. But on a much larger scale, man, that kind of thing really makes a difference. And it's a really big part of why counseling can have such an influence on people.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, I over the years, I think too, Ryan, that we all have a little bit of a fear of being found out, you know? And I think that's one of the barriers to people getting counseling services, or one of the reasons counseling can be stigmatized, is it's like, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to share my deepest hurts and biggest flaws, and my counselor's going to think I'm a bad person, or people who see me walking out of the office are going to think I'm a bad person. I think we all have some fear of being found out, but it's really not until I am fully known that some of my greatest hurts and flaws can begin to be changed. Yeah. So there really is something important that happens When I am found out, what clients over the years have told me is that it is so liberating. At first, it was such a fearful thing that I'm going to be found out. But man, yeah, then to share and to be fully known, man, it's so freeing.
Yeah, and I think what I would tell people, you know, if anyone's watching this, right, and I've had my own counseling, Trent, I think you've been
for sure, yeah, lots.
Yeah, so likewise, you know, I think I would tell people you actually have the power, and what I mean by that is, it's up to you in terms of what counselor you see. So I would encourage you, take that first step, reach out with a counselor, sit down with them. And if you don't like them, find somebody else, period. That's how it works. Find another counselor. And for some people, it may take 2 or 3 counselors before they actually have a conversation with someone and like, I kind of click with them. Like, this works, I feel comfortable, I feel safe. And I would encourage people to remember that. You know, so I think some of the fears in terms of what are they gonna think about me? You know, what if I get a label? I mean, all these different things. You really have the power in choosing who you get to tell your story to. And if they're not it, then go find someone else, period. And I would say, take that first step, reach out to someone and give it a shot. And if they're not the right fit, keep looking, because you will find the right counselor. In Colorado, there's over 10,000 professional counselors in Colorado. There's a lot of people out there who are willing to sit down with you and hear your story. And there's also a lot of people out there who are more than happy to engage a biblically based Christian perspective into ethical clinical mental health counseling and incorporate that into your story and into your journey and into the processing. Also, if you're interested in receiving clinical services, we do, the CCU Master of Arts in Clinical Mental Health Counseling program does have a community counseling center in Colorado Springs, but Trent, you guys are also offering teletherapy services as well, right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. So COVID has made telehealth the rule as opposed to the exception. Yeah. And absolutely, our agency is staffed by clinicians who are excellent. As you said, Ryan, we integrate evidence-based clinical mental health counseling with principles of faith to help people through different struggles in life. And whether it's us or somebody else, yep. Absolutely. My encouragement to anybody listening who's considering it, take the step. I promise you'll be glad that you did.
Awesome. Thank you for joining us. If you're interested in learning more about the Community Counseling Center, maybe seeking help with Dr. Langhofer or one of our students, check out the information below. Also, we have a blog talking about some of the mental health stigmas. That's also in the information below. We hope you join us next time.